Hi everyone, in this video we are building Voron Trident, a do-it-yourself Corex Y 3D printer from Voron Design. I think I have everything for the build, the Blurolls 3D printer kit for the Trident. Thank you Blurolls, I unboxed it in my previous video. A flat surface, this is important. 3D printed parts, I printed almost everything. The last bits are printing right now. A PC to follow the manual from Voron Design. I will have a helping table to help me organize the different stages of the project. Some tools. I'm ready. Let's build it. For this build, I'll be using mainly the official assembly manual. This build involves electrical works with main voltage. Please read the disclaimer. The manual is very detailed and nearly 280 pages. It is a step-by-step illustrated guide and contains all tips and explanation to help you build the machine, starting with basic description and identification of the mechanical components. The first step is to identify the extrusions used in the frame. The standard sizes of the Trident are 250x250, 300x300 and 350x350 mm, and the sizes given for the extrusions here are for the 250 build. If you are building one of the other builds, you'll have to identify your profiles by deduction and by looking at the holes and tapings. The first stage is to build the frame. Here you need a flat surface, a tool to check right angles, and a screwdriver. Take your time, because any misalignment on this stage will lead to issues later on that will be difficult to solve. Reading every page of the manual helps to avoid going back like me here, because I forgot to insert a profile.
Here is very important moment when we build the frame to align well the extrusions for the y-axis. In the manual is written to use as support 330 mm extrusion. Normally the manual is written for the 250 version of the printer. Here I'm building the 300 version, and I don't have a second 330 mm extrusion to use, so I will have either to take this one out. There's no issue when the screw is already in the 2020 extrusion, or I will have to measure very well with different tool.
I ended up using the 330 mm extrusion from the back. It is the most precise way to align the y-axis extrusions. Sorry for the out of focus video here, unfortunately there was no way to reshoot it. The total video is 1 hour. And if you are interested in particular topic, please check the description. There are chapters and links to different stages of the build. I tried to shoot everything in a time lapse with focus on the most critical processes. Total build time was around 30 hours over several days. Here the main frame is almost done and I checked again the right angles and the screws tightening. Now I built belt tensioners and the A and B drives that move the printhead on X and Y. The design of the parts relies on many threaded heat inserts, and if you never worked with those, in the manual there is a link to video tutorial you may want to check. The belt tensioners and A and B drives have the same design as on the Voron 2.4. The two printers share many similar components, especially for the X and Y axis and the gantry. When building the belt tensioners, don't tighten the main screw yet, the one that contains the idler. It should move easily and will be tightened after adjusting the belt tension later on. Building the A&B drives is very easy and Voron provides now a printable tool to adjust the position of the pulley on the stepper shaft. This didn't exist when I built my 2.4 and it saves a lot of time. Use thread locker for the screws of the pulley. It will prevent potential issues caused by loosened screws. I used drop of instant glue instead, but blue thread locker is certainly the best option if you have it. The screws and nuts in the Blurolls kit are of excellent quality. For the 2020 profiles are used rolling nuts with ball, which allow them to stay in position when rotating the frame. The screws are black and the steel seem hardened because I didn't have any issues tightening and untightening some of them several times while adjusting the components. My kit was supplied with Hall Effect Sensor, which is a contactless replacement for the X and Y end stops. It works with two magnets installed here at the end of the Y axis and on the printhead. The sensor is polarity sensitive and you should install the magnets after powering the sensors with 5 volts and testing the right orientation. I did this already, but if you don't have a 5 volts adapter, install the magnets last after your wiring is done.
One of the main advantages of the Blurolls kit are the linear rails. They are genuine high wind and slide grade. Out of the packaging, the rails have to be cleaned because there is some conservation liquid on them. I used isopropyl alcohol for the cleaning. Then you have to grease them. High wind rails have a hole for oiling and you can use it. My grease syringe was too large for the hole and I had to slide the carriage out of the rail and apply grease directly on the small rolling balls. Here I'm installing the mounts for the Z motors. On the Z axis, the Trident has three linear rails and three steppers with integrated lead screws. These three steppers are independent, each of them needs a separate stepper driver. They make possible to perform a 3-point bed leveling, which is the main new feature of the Trident over the previous version of this printer, the Voron 1.8. Installing the linear rails is fast. Voron provides a printable tool to center the rail on the profile. For the positioning of the roll-in nuts, I measured the distance between every second hole of the rail, which is 40 mm in this case, and then I arranged the nuts in the profile at the same distance. Here I mount the right, left and rear Z joints. These parts will support the build plate. They integrate the lead screw nuts and mount on the Z linear rails. Before installing the Z steppers, I applied some grease on the lead screws, as per the manual. However, it's better to grease them later on, because this grease ended up on my quads. There are so many operations remaining and it is impossible to not touch the lead screws. This is the assembly of the XY joints. They support the gantry and slide on the Y-axis linear rails. The gantry consists of one 2020 extrusion profile and a large MGN12 linear rail for the print head. The linear rail has to be cleaned and greased. Voron provides printable tool to center this linear rail and the installation is pretty easy. The gantry assembly is mounted on the Y-axis linear rails and it has to be squared. Here I prepare the printhead carriage and the joint between the X and the Y energy chains. They will be needed for the next two operations, squaring the gantry and installing the belts.
Now it's important stage to square the gantry. If you follow the manual so far, these screws should not be tightened. Then to square the gantry, we have to move it next to the A and B drives. Press it there and screw.
There are 6 screws to tighten, 4 on top and 2 on the bottom. Keep the gantry pressed to the A and B drives while tightening. If everything until now was done correctly and with care, the gantry should slide easily.
Okay, it seems fine.
Corex Y printers require equal belt tension. The easiest way to achieve it is to use belts with the same length. So here I had to install the first belt, cut it, then remove it and cut a second belt with the same length. Then install again the two belts. After installing the belts, I tightened the tensioners in the same position and checked by hand that belts have similar tension. In this process, the gantry should remain squared. If it has changed position and one of the sides is not touching the A or B drives, it means one of the belts is looser than the other. Play with the tensioners and assure it is still squared. I finished the assembly of the printhead carriage and installed the second magnet for the hole sensor. Again, install the magnets on this stage only if you check before what is the right polarity. Otherwise, install them after your hole sensor is powered up. Here is the Omron inductive probe used for 3-point bed leveling. I cut its wires at approximately 16 cm. The wires will be extended with less bulk PTFE wires that are the best option for the cable chains. I applied a layer of high-temperature silicone on the probe to keep it safe from the heat of the hot end, and I'm ready for the assembly of the afterburner. This is the direct print head used on Voron printers. Here the manual advises to assemble and install the hotbed. However, I believe it's better to install first the print head and the wiring for X and Y, because you'll have more space to work. I won't spend much time on assembling the afterburner. It is well documented. It's a nice direct extruder print head supporting creation of hot ends including K3D, Mosquito, Dragon and Dragonfly. The Blurolls kit comes with high flow Dragon hot end. It's an excellent device. And the only change I'll make is to replace the standard 0.4 nozzle with a 0.6 one, because I found it more adapted to large volume fast printers. When assembling the extruder and the hot end, it's good to test that the filament goes easily all the way to the nozzle.
Just one comment here about the blower. I print normally those from polycarbonate because they are more temperature resistant to, you know, the hot end. They will not melt. Now, I didn't have black polycarbonate, so I painted it with ABS slurry. So it just to have the same color as the other parts.
Regarding the wiring, I didn't use the supplied silicone wires, which are prescribed by Voron, by the way, because I had some PTFE wires remaining from my 2.4 build, and I believe they are better suited for the energy chains. My PTFE wires are black only, and I used pieces of isolation from silicone wires to make identification labels. Also, I don't use connectors here for connecting the wires of the fans and the instrumentation to the PTFE extension wires. I just connect wire to wire because I found it easier to maintain and less bulk. The only connector I use is for the inductive probe, because the moment it fails, it will get replaced by the clicky probe. The energy chains in the Blurolls kit are openable and pulling the wires is very easy. The Pancake LDO extruder stepper is high temperature version, and it comes already with kind of PTFE wires. They are long enough to reach the joint element between the X and Y energy chains and can be extended there, out of the chains and in fixed position. I opened the links of the X chain with a screwdriver and it was a bit of pain. But for the Y chain, I discovered the accessory I had from the IGUS chains on my 2.4 is working great to open these chains also. Here you see the wiring pads for X and Y down to the electronics compartment. The whole sensor wiring was a bit of trouble because it came with a male Molex connector without the female connector. So I used their DuPont connectors and at the end it worked fine. The build plate in the Blurolls kit is awesome, and with excellent flatness. I tested it with a bed mesh in my previous unboxing video. Blurolls claims it is MIC6. It comes with magnetic sticker, silicone heater and PEI coated steel spring sheet. Before applying the magnetic sticker, I cleaned the surface with isopropyl alcohol for better adhesion. Then the process is very much like installing a screen protector on your phone and chasing air bubbles. After applying the magnetic sticker, I had to drill holes for the screws that attach the build plate to the supporting frame. I did this with my screwdriver by progressively increasing the diameter of the tool. Installing the silicone heater is similar. It is 600 watts and it has to be positioned in the center of the build plate. Thermal fuse has also to be installed as an additional safety device. It is connected in series to the heater on one of the power wires. The build plate has two M3 tapings in this area. One for the thermal fuse and one for a protective earth wire. Here I am building the supporting frame for the hotbed and the elements that contain the spherical bearings needed for the 3-point bed leveling. As many other printed parts on this printer, I printed those 100% infill 5 perimeters. The Z end stop is the last component for the hotbed. I am building this first time because on the 2.4 I used the inductive probe also as an end stop and later on I switched to the clicky probe also used as an end stop. For the trident I decided to comply with the specs and use it.
Inserting the pulley was a pain because I didn't read the manual. In fact, the pulley has to be inserted first because then you can apply force to insert it. Then with the wires here, it's a bit more tricky. But okay, I did it.
This is how looks the wiring of the hotbed and the probe. It is securely attached with cable ties. Don't forget to screw the protective earth wire here, like me. I did it afterwards and I had to redo the cable ties. The hotbed assembly installation on the printer is very easy. And here you see how it should be able to move independently on the three lead screws. The three-point bed leveling basically aligns the plane of the bed with the plane in which operates the gantry. New day here, and I'll be fighting the electronics compartment. First, I installed the 2-DIN rails at approximately equal distance from the edges and between them. Then I installed the Raspberry Pi, the power supplies and the control board on printable mounts for DIN rail. The standard control board with the Blurolls kit is the Spider, but you can also request the Big 3 Tech Octopus, which I did in order to have the same brand electronics for the display, control board and the stepper drivers. The solid state relay is supplied with its own metal DIN rail bracket that serves also as a heatsink.
So, as you see, there are plenty of space for the wiring. I have to extend some wires here for the silicone heater. You see the power wires are not long enough to reach the solid state relay and the thermistor wire as well. So this have to be extended. Other than this, I cut my own wires, so everything else should have enough length. Another thing, I rearranged here a little bit. I didn't do it exactly like Voron specified. Actually, the control board and the Raspberry Pi are reversed. I did it this way because here I have a little bit more space and I think I'll have to design something to hold the cables here, maybe something with double-sided VHB tape that I will fix on the bottom, and then with cable ties I can have the cables right here.
This is what I came up with. I realized I had to design it a bit longer and with less cable ties, but I'll use it for now.
Now, in this area, we have the master switch here with the fuse and the cable entry. So from the other side, it has the earthing. It goes directly to the PCU. Here is the neutral. Sorry. earthing, neutral, and here is the line. The line goes through the fuse here, then should go to the switch and then go to the PCU. So with this I supplied two cables.
Four wires actually.
So we have the, I think this is the earthing. This goes direct to the PCU. And this should be neutral and line. So we will have neutral and line here after the switch. And there is one cable to make the link after the fuse to the switch. So here I've done the power connections. So we have the cable entering here, a switch, then the line, the neutral and the earthing goes first to the small 5 volts PCU. I use here the same terminals to get the line, the neutral and the earth for the main PCU. From the terminals here I get the line going to the solid state relay, and then when the solid state relay receives a command from the control board, it will switch on, and so the line goes to the hotbed. And then I have this another wire from the hotbed going to the neutral.
Now the protective earthing should be connected to all metal parts where there is main voltage. The build plate, the main power supply and the small 5 volts power supply. I prepared the board for the wiring. There are some jumpers to take out for UART control and other jumpers to install elsewhere. All this is documented for the Octopus board on the Voron website. There is also a wiring diagram for this board. It is both for the 2.4 and the Trident. The Trident has one stepper less and I'll have just 6 steppers and 2 free sockets. The other change will be for the Hall effect sensor. It needs 5 volts and I'll take these 5 volts from the nail pixel output. So for the X end stop I'll keep just the signal wire in the middle and the other wire will go to the 5 volts on the nail pixel port. Though the board can manage a 24 volts inductive probe on a dedicated port, it seems it doesn't quite work with clipper yet, and I'll use a standard setup with BAT85 diode, also described in the Voron documentation. The wiring is relatively simple. I spent most time in making the JST connectors for the instrumentation and the fans. I also used a JST connector to supply 5 volts to the Raspberry Pi through the pins. I am relatively happy how the wiring looks. The wires were made as compact as possible and they will not interfere much with the airflow. The display is also from Big Tree Tech and it connects to the board without making any modifications to the wiring. The casing of the display is gorgeous. It is similar to the one on the 2.4, but with better hinge. The skirts were also redesigned and have the same height, like on the 2.4. At this stage I installed the Octoprint server on the Raspberry Pi. This is well documented and I won't go in details. You can also install 2 other print servers, Mansell, OS and Fluid. Both are more dedicated environments to run Clipper. If you have a touch display, there is also the Moonraker and Clipper screen. Myself, I'm used to Octoprint and its rich plugin catalog, so for now I'll stay with this server. On the Voron website there are instructions how to install Clipper and how to flash the firmware on your control board. The firmware could be flashed through USB cable or with an SD card. Myself, I used the SD card option and didn't have any issues. This is the assembly of the fans for the electronics compartment. They are fixed to the skirts with VHB tape.
So regarding the electronics fans, those are quite powerful. They're normally working all the time, like when the heated bed is turned on, they also receive a command to blow. And it's noisy. I don't like them to work all the time because I'm sure in many cases it's not needed. Like here, for example, the control board uses TMC2209 drivers, which were dramatically improved in terms of thermal management compared to the previous versions. I use the same drivers on my CR10 without any heating at all.
Without any cooling, sorry.
So what I decided to do is to make the ventilation here in the electronics bay a little bit smarter, and I installed 2 additional thermistors, one here on the PCU and one here on the heat sink of the extruder. Normally the extruder driver is the one that gets most load, and if something heats up, it's the extruder driver. So there is a thermistor from the extruder driver, from the PCU,
And then I will make something simple in the clipper configuration file sake, like if this temperature goes above 50 degrees, turn this fan on, and if here the temperature at the heatsink goes above 50 or 60 degrees, turn the second fan on. Let's see.
I used some old thermistors here, probably leftovers from my CR10 projects. Here you see how I attached them on the PCU casing and on the extruder driver heatsink. I used the glue from a 3M heat transfer sticker to fix the thermistor on the heatsink. Now starts the fun. I need clipper configuration file to get the printer working, and Voron doesn't provide yet such configuration for the Octopus board. I found on Voron's Discord a user-contributed file I'll use as a starting point. I edited the file for my setup, renamed it printer config, and uploaded it to the Raspberry Pi. Let's look at the final file and see what were the main edits. It starts with list of settings the user should look at and verify or change, like the MCU path, thermistors type and PID values, X and Y distances to the Z end stop, etc. Then there is a list of pin definitions. Finding the MCU path is well documented on Voron's website, but there is also a reminder how to do it in the file. This is essential for the communication with the board. Then basically you should check if all the values and pins apply to your equipment and your wiring. To check the pins and the connections, I had to compare the configuration file with the pins layout of the Octopus board. For the X and Y stepper definitions, check if your motors are 0.9 or 1.8 degree. The Blurolls kit comes with 0.9 degree LDO steppers for X and Y, and the value for the full steps per rotation should be 400. For the Z steppers, it's important to know the lead of the lead screw. It is most probably 8 or 4. Initially, I was confused because I used 8. This is what is written in the Blurolls bill of materials on their AliExpress listing. But if you look at the pictures of the steppers below, you'll see the lead is 4. So the rotation distance parameter for the Z steppers should be 4. My extruder stepper is connected to the 6th stepper driver, which is motor 5 on the board, because the first one is motor 0. Take into account this way of numbering if you change the pins. I haven't changed anything else in this chapter except the PID values after performing tuning. I changed also the PID values for the hotbed. Here in the fan control chapter you see the two definitions I created for the electronics fans. The controller fan and the PCU fan are defined as temperature fan with watermark type of control. Max delta is the hysteresis around the targeted temperature. I had to go as low as 30 degrees Celsius for the targeted temperature in order to get the fans running half of the time. I will increase this to 40 degrees in order to have them running only when needed. Take into account that now is winter and the temperature here in the attic is around 18 degrees Celsius. In the summer, they will work more frequently. In the home override definition, he specified the location of the Z end stop. I found it by homing X and Y, jogging to the position of the end stop using the controls in OctoPrint, and registering the X and Y values displayed on the screen. You see that completing the configuration requires few checks on a running printer. It means uploading the file, testing, editing, and uploading again. This is the display definition, and here you may want to edit the colors for the display and the turning knob. Then are the parameters for the Z tilt function. This is for the 3-point bed leveling. I didn't change anything here. There are also parameters for bed mesh. I kept the definition, however, I won't perform bed mesh at print start because this bed is flat and I don't need any dynamic corrections. If your bed is not absolutely flat, you may want to use bed mesh calibrate after the Z tilt adjust command. Before unclosing the printer, I tested everything again, the hotbed, the extruder, homing, 3-point bed leveling. Everything was working fine. The Raspberry Pi came without any heat sinks, so I improvised here and used pulley and idlers on the processor, the RAM and the USB controller. At least I'll know where to find the pulley if I need it. I'm now ready to unclose the printer, starting with the electronics compartment. The Blurolls kit comes with a set of 3mm thick acrylic panels, glossy black for the back, the bottom and the dock, and transparent for the top, the sides and the doors. They are precisely cut and look beautiful. Under the side, top and rear panels, I applied 6mm thick foam tape. It is not included in the kit, but it's cheap and largely available at any shop dealing with construction materials or windows and doors. With this tape, I printed the larger 6mm corners and middle clips provided by Voron. On the back are installed also a spool holder and a holder for the tube to the print head, as well the exhaust filter. On the sides, the foam tape is applied on the Y-axis 2020 extrusions also, and here it helps to dump vibrations. When the panels are in place, it's not easy to grip and handle the printer, and I installed also two handles on top. For the doors, I used more solid hinges than those provided by Voron. You can find them in the user mods directory on Voron's GitHub. As you see, the doors close very well, no gap. Now I'm ready to print few test prints from ABS. Like the other unclosed Voron printers, the Trident should be good with ABS. This is the filament I print most. Of course, the Afterburner print head is also great for printing TPU, PETG and PLA at open doors. Regarding the PLA, some users find the part cooling poor at very high speeds, and if PLA is important for you, there are some user modifications using bigger fan or two fans you can find on Voron GitHub. The printer is performing 3-point bed leveling here, aligning the plane of the bed to the gantry. This is done with the inductive probe. Then the Z end stop is used for the Z offset. I defined my Z offset the experimental way with few tries, starting with smaller values to avoid hitting the nozzle in the bed. Nowadays there are scripts to define the Z offset automatically, but it's one-time setup, so I did it manually. My first print was the Voron calibration cube, printed at 0.2 layer height. It printed very fine without visible artifacts. Next, I printed large mask at 0.4 layer height. With this 6-hour print, I wanted to test how good is the printer for ABS, because this mask is entirely on supports and any bending of the ABS part when cooling would be fatal. It printed fine with some irregular layers due to overheating in the fast layers. It is related to fine-tuning the profile, speed and cooling, but I didn't see any issues related to the mechanics. My last test print was 28 hours. It is the Moon City model available from my manufacturer. I printed it at 0.2 layer height, and it is really awesome for an ABS print.
Let's wrap up both for the printer and the Blurolls kit. This printer so far seems great. Same or similar level of performance like the Voron 2.4. The benefit is it's much easier to build. In fact, I would rank it on the same level like the switch wire. Then the Voron 2.4 is a bit more complex to build. And the most difficult for me was to build the small Voron 0.1, in fact. Maybe because my eyes are not what they used to be. The 3-point bed leveling seems to work fine, at least. So far I didn't have any failed prints. Each time the first layer is perfect. So, yeah, it's another excellent Voron machine. Now about the Blurolls kit, I honestly think this is a quality kit and it's perfectly fine to build a Trident. It comes with great components, high wind linear rails, day slide grade, the bed is flat and Blurolls claims it's MAC6. LDO motors everywhere, Dragon high flow hot end, Raspberry Pi 4, I got the 4GB version, Octopus board. I'm very happy with the panels, they are very transparent, precisely cut based on Voron drawings, fit perfectly. Also the profiles of the frame are matte black, very similar to the Misumi profiles I have on my 2.4, and they didn't suffer from the assembly, at least there are no visible marks. So yeah, I can only recommend this kit. The only thing I changed here were actually the wires. The kit came with silicone wires, by the way specified by Voron. But I had some PTFE wires left from the 2.4 build, so I used the PTFE wires where I could. So that's all from me. Though this was the longest video I ever made, for sure I forgot to say or explain something. It will be most probably in the description. Or don't hesitate to ask your questions in the comments. If you are still awake, thanks for watching and see you for my next project. Bye bye.